Now, friends, we've been, last week we kind of checked out a bit of a high point in Peter's journey with Jesus. You'll remember that Peter was a fisherman called to follow Jesus. Dropped his nets, left his boat, and he followed Jesus. And he wandered around Galilee with 12 others, with 11 others and Jesus, so 12 disciples. And we saw last week how Peter saw Jesus. Peter saw him for who he was, and he declared that. While they were on the field trip to Caesarea Philippi, Peter declared him to be the Christ, the Son of the living God. Clear orientation. He had seen the miracles. He had heard the teaching. He had been watching Jesus, and he declared it. Now, the interesting thing about being oriented to who Jesus is, I think we can all, many of us anyways, could probably express times where we've experienced some of that orientation. A bit of a mountaintop experience where the world seemed clear. We thought we had our way. We thought we knew what was up. We thought we had everything figured out. And then came the phone call, the diagnosis, the conflict, the bill collector, whatever it is. And we kind of got spun up. And maybe that what we thought we knew, we didn't know anymore. We had some doubts. We had some uncertainty. We weren't so sure anymore. Well, what do we do in that place? That place where when orientation has given way to disorientation, where maybe, again, we aren't so sure about what we were so sure before. So talking about Peter. Peter, again, had been walking with Jesus, and last week we saw this mountaintop experience. It wasn't the only mountaintop experience. Peter had a knack of putting himself in positions to experience Jesus. Do you remember the time on the boat, and there's a storm, and Jesus came out to the disciples walking on the water? And they were wondering if it was a ghost. But then when they recognized it was Jesus, Peter yelled, "Lord, if it's you, invite me out onto the waters with you." Jesus said, "Come." And Peter stepped down onto the water and took a couple steps, walking like Jesus on the water. But then he saw the wind and he saw the waves, and where, again, the orientation point on Jesus grew to disorientation and he began to sink. Well, he was saved and had that moment. But that moment of walking on the waves, I think, would have stuck with him. Right? That moment where kind of it broke through into the miraculous. He saw Jesus. He knew who he was. He knew what he was about. The thing is, though, even though Peter saw Jesus, and even though Peter declared him to be the Christ, the Son of the living God, Peter applied his own assumptions to what that meant, right? He applied his own understanding to what that meant, and in turn, it actually was a misunderstanding. You see, within that culture, the Jews had been waiting for the promised Messiah, a Messiah that would come and conquer the oppressors, a Messiah that would come and restore Israel to its high point, one who would walk in the pattern of King David. Right? The messianic promised one. And they had assumptions about what this one would look like. And so after this moment that we saw last week where Peter declared Jesus to be the Christ, the Son of the living God, immediately following, the next pericope, the next story, the next segment we see Matthew record is a juxtaposition of this high point. There's a contrast here. So if you have your Bibles in Matthew 16, verse 21 says that from that time on, so this is following Peter's declaration, following the disciples, kind of having this high point of in Caesarea Philippi, knowing that Jesus is the Messiah, and from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, and then on the third day raised to life. So immediately after Peter declares him to be the Christ, we see that Jesus starts to try to correct their misunderstanding of what that meant. What it meant that he was the Messiah. Just so you know, we're going to Jerusalem. I'm suffering a lot and I'm going to die. Well, Peter speaks up. Peter, the one who declared him to be the Christ, who spoke for the 12, who spoke for the disciples, who had that mountaintop experience, who heard from Jesus' own lips, yeah, I'm the Messiah. You know, you didn't learn this from human voices. It was divinely revealed to you that I'm the Christ. So Peter knows what he knows, but he doesn't know what he doesn't know. In verse 22, Peter took him aside. So you think this, Peter takes the teacher aside, takes his rabbi aside and says, hey, hold on, I got to correct you on something. He took him aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord, he said. This shall never happen to you. Because if he was the Messiah, if he was the Christ, if he is the one that was going to conquer the oppressors, how is he going to die? Right? Again, we see his misunderstanding. Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, and you do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. The previous story, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Now, yeah, you're the rock, but you're a stumbling rock, right? You're a stumbling block. Interesting juxtaposition going on here, right? We see immense highs, and then we see the immense lows. Because Peter is moving in his misunderstanding of who Jesus is. His misunderstanding of who Jesus is. And then Jesus continues, not only get behind me, Satan, then in verse 24, Jesus said this to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. These disciples, declaring him to be the Messiah, thought Jesus is going to solve all of our nation's problems. We know he can feed people. We saw him feed 5,000 people. And then we saw him feed 4,000 people. What that guy can do with bread and fish if he was only king. Well, one day, we're going to make him king. We're going to overthrow those who are oppressing us. Jesus affirms, yeah, I'm the Messiah. But again, the misunderstandings, Peter bringing his own assumptions, his own presuppositions to who the Messiah was, what he was all about. Jesus is essentially saying, friends, the cross, you all know this as a form of Roman execution. And those who went to the cross would carry their cross as a form of that punishment. Whoever wants to be my disciple must take up their cross and follow me. Be willing to lose their life. Be willing to give it all. A sacrifice. If you followed me for health, if you followed me for wealth, if you followed me for prosperity, as the world defines these things, you're going to be disappointed. Following me is about sacrificing. But in that sacrifice, whoever loses their life for me will find it. There will be a new life given, new character, new texture, new quality, new characteristics of life that is really life. But you must be willing to sacrifice all the goodness of this world. And we see the next story. So we have the high point, you're the Christ. The next point, no, never, Lord. Get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block. And then the next point, Jesus goes up onto the mountain. And he takes his three closest friends there, Simon, Peter, and James, and John, the sons of Zebedee. And they go up onto the mountain. And there we have this sort of miraculous event of the transfiguration. Verse 2 says of chapter 17 says, there he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as light. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Now Peter sees this, and he responds. Peter said this to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up three shelters, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. And friends, while he was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." Peter is disrupted by God speaking. Peter, again, thinks he's declaring goodness, and yet he needs to be interrupted. Hold up. This is my son. You listen to him. You don't declare your own agenda. You don't declare your own way. Peter is, you know, striking out, swinging, missing on these interactions with Jesus. He thinks he sees, and he thinks he knows, and he thinks he understands. And yet he's missing it. He's missing it. Well, they have some more ministry, and Jesus and his disciples follow through. Jesus leads them down to Jerusalem, and they enter Jerusalem amidst the cries and the shouts of Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And all of this would, again, connect in the minds of the disciples. This stuff would be affirming their assumptions. Look at the crowds. Look at the cheers. Look at this. We have an army here before us, and they are for Jesus. They come into Jerusalem. They have their time together in the upper room, right? Those intimate dialogue, intimate conversations. Jesus is pouring out his heart. He's praying for them. Have you ever had just an incredible meal with friends or family? Right? The conversation is great. The humor hits on every mark. No one says anything awkward that throws the conversation off. You're just on this relational high. Everyone feels so good. Well, this is this moment that they have with Jesus, right? He's bringing them forward, and they would reflect a lot about what took place at this meal. But they're in this moment of a high point. It's an emotional night. There's connection, and there's so much meaning there, and they're leaving the room, right? And they're going down. They're making their way to the Garden of Gethsemane, and they're talking. And Jesus says in verse 31, this is chapter 26, "Then Jesus told them, 'This very night you will fall away on account of me. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee.'" Now, Peter replied, again, Peter, the one who kept swinging and missing, who tried so hard, he speaks up. And he said, "Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will." It's a bold declaration. And Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you," Jesus answered, "this very night, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." Not just once, Peter. Three times. And Peter declared, "Even if I have to die with you, I'll never disown you." "You're wrong, Jesus. I've given everything and I'm here with you. I'm willing to die." Now, the interesting here is that, again, I think Peter continues to apply his own assumptions to the situation. Right? The thought of dying for a cause that you believe in. "Even if all others run away, not I. I'm sticking with you. I'm going with you into battle to overthrow the Roman oppressors." There's something about giving your life in a heroic death, right? Something that you're at the center of attention. You're following your rabbi, your teacher, into a revolutionary war, and you're going to go down in the history books as one who fought to free your people. "I'm willing to die for this cause," Peter said. He is, again, applying his expectations. He's applying his own assumptions. And Jesus is like, "Dude." They enter into the garden. Jesus takes with him Peter, James, and John again, the same three that saw him transfigured on the mountain. And you really, this is one of the most beautiful scenes that I see of Jesus. You see his humanity in full view. He's in the garden, and he says to his three friends, his three closest companions that he had on earth. Verse 7, again, 37, he says he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. And he said, this is Jesus' expression, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Fellas, I'm struggling. I need you. Will you support me? Will you come alongside? Will you lift me up? So then he goes a little further and he falls with his face to the ground and he prays, my Father, if it's possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. And he comes back to his friends. Verse 40 says, he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Sleeping. My soul is overcome with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. And they fell asleep. Well, he wakes them up and he says, couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. There's three of them, but the text says he asked Peter. Peter was the one who just said, I'm going to die for you. And yet he couldn't even stay awake to support him in his hour of grief. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Isn't this the way of it? All too often. Jesus, I'll follow you anywhere. Especially if it's a big thing. Especially if people will take notice. Especially if I get a little something, something by this following you. But what about the little moments, day by day by day? Peter, just keep watch. But I'm so tired, Jesus. He's willing to give his life, but he can't even stay awake. Well, Jesus goes away for a second time. Prays the same prayer. My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away, unless I drink it, may your will be done. Again, this submissive spirit of not my will, but your will be done. And then he returns back to his three friends. Are you still sleeping? Oh, sorry, the second time. They're sleeping still. They're still sleeping. And he goes to pray a third time, and he returns to the disciples, and he says, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come. The Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. When he needed Peter most, Peter dropped the ball. And then in this moment again, we see Peter with his mixed up assumptions, his mixed up understanding of what Jesus was actually about. The soldiers come and they're arresting Jesus. Verse 51 says, with that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Now, John 18 says that this was Simon Peter who did this. So Peter acts on his own assumptions. Again, no, you're not going to die because you need to overthrow. You're the Messiah. You need to take care of the Romans for us. Get behind me, Satan. And he's like up there on the mountain. Hey, we should build three structures. He's interrupted by God to say, hey, listen to Jesus. Now, I'll never leave you. And then he goes and takes a nap. They're being arrested and he pulls out a sword and he cuts off the soldier's ear. And Jesus says, put your sword back in its place. For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way? The kingdom's not coming by force. It's not coming by power. It's not coming by bloodshed. It's not coming by war. It's not coming by manipulation. It's not coming by power plays. This is the way of Jesus. Even though so many get it twisted, right? So many get it twisted. It's interesting now, we are living in a time where the way of Jesus in the world, specifically also in the media, is getting really twisted. There's many that say they are walking in step with Jesus and they want to bring the kingdom of heaven by power or might or by political means. Right? It's all falling under this term of Christian nationalism. And while it's mostly south of the border, we see it creeping north of the border as well. You cannot legislate the kingdom of heaven. It does not come by force. It comes through the way of the cross. Right? And he would be my disciple. Take up their cross and follow me. Take up their cross and follow me. Well, at this point, Jesus is arrested, and those disciples who said, "Never, Lord, never, I will never leave you," well, they scatter. Verse 56 says, "Then all the disciples deserted him and fled." We'll never go! Well, where is everybody? Crickets, right? Crickets. Well, as Jesus is taken away, Peter actually follows at a distance. Verse 58 says, but Peter followed them at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. Now, the scene is set, right? Jesus has been arrested. He's being tried. Peter has made his way in at a distance, though, trying to stay hidden. Verse 69 of chapter 26 says, now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. And you also were with Jesus of Galilee, she said. Now, interestingly, Peter, fisherman, and a servant comes and asks. This is the one that said he would die for Jesus. And yet a servant girl can throw him off? Servant girl asks. He denied it before all of them. I don't know what you're talking about, he says. He dodges. Right? He dodges the accusation. And in fact, there's some classic gaslighting going on. I don't know what you're talking about. I can almost see a little bit more text. Like, she's only a servant girl. She doesn't know what she's talking about. Then he went out to the gateway where another servant girl saw him and said to the people there, this fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth. He got up from the fire and he moved into the shadows away from the warmth and away from the light of the fire. And there again, he's accused. Aren't you one that was with Jesus of Nazareth? We see in his denial, he ups the ante, right? I don't even know the man. Don't know the man, he said with an oath. He denies with disassociation. Jesus? Who's that? After a little while, in Luke's account, says it was about an hour. After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, surely you're one of them. Your accent gives you away. You sound like Jesus. You sound like his followers. Your accent gives you away. And he began to call down curses. And he swore to them, I don't know the man. Now, when you see this call down curses, he's making these oaths. He's calling down a solemn curse on himself if he's lying. And he's professing the truthfulness of his word by swearing by something that's holy, something sacred. And yet he's lying the whole time. I don't know the man. Immediately the rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the words Jesus had spoken. Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. And he went outside and he wept bitterly. Now Luke adds that during this interaction, after Peter denied that third time, Luke records that Jesus looked at him and their eyes met. And again, we saw in the cartoon that they pictured it through a window. Right, it zoomed out and it looked like Jesus looked at him through the window. We don't really know. That's kind of an artistic. It could have been through a window. It could have been as Jesus was being led across the courtyard. But their eyes made contact. From a distance, there was an intimate moment. And the disappointment was felt. with just this heavy clarity, this intimate exchange, right? It was an exclamation point on Peter's failure. And Peter went out and he wept bitterly. He wept bitterly. We see throughout all of these stories, Peter's disorientation. He missed it. Where he thought he had crystal clarity, he had these misunderstandings. He had these assumptions that didn't play. And Peter walked with Jesus, and he watched Jesus, and he listened to him. Friends, we're now removed 2,000 years. We're now removed in time and place, right? We're in a different culture. We're in a different time. We're in a different setting. If Peter could misunderstand who Jesus was and what he was about, then maybe we can sometimes drop the ball too. Some of the assumptions we bring to faith, some of the assumptions we bring to our understanding of things, sometimes we're messed up. We need to have a little bit of humility to fall back in line with what Jesus is doing, right? With what Jesus is doing. A kingdom that comes not through force, not through might, not through violence, but through the way of the cross. Friends, it's my prayer that we would reflect on what this invitation is, to follow Jesus as Jesus presents himself, not maybe what the church has just assumed all these years. Because again, we see time after time that Christian teachers can get it twisted, just like Peter could get it twisted. Instead of the orientation and the clear declarations that he is the Christ, we start to assume what we think that may mean. And we heap guilt and shame, and we call people to account in ways that actually sometimes create more harm than good. It ends up not being the way of Jesus. It ends up being the way of the world, the way of power, the way of control. So friends, I want to encourage you to reflect on Peter's journey, the disorientation that's so clearly articulated through these stories. And then maybe ask yourself a question that all too often we fail to ask ourselves. Maybe where do we have it twisted? Maybe where do we have assumptions that aren't actually of Christ? They've come to us through other ways, and we need to realign ourselves to who Jesus is and what he's up to in the world. Won't you pray with me? Gracious Father, we thank you that Jesus shows us a different way in the world. And I just pray that we would have the courage to reflect on our own journeys and our own understandings and maybe our own misunderstandings. May your Spirit bring clarity. And may we walk in the pattern of Christ in the world. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.